excited to have everyone here, and we're really excited to really focus on Father's Day this time. And I do want to shout out to Sharon, my wife, and Bodhi, who are watching, because I got to teach them what I want to have for dinner this Sunday. Are we good? So anyway, take notes, everyone. We're going to focus on steak today. And, you know, one of the cool things we're doing, this really cool promotion on Premium Choice Certified Angus Beef. And I'll be using that product today. Really great product. What we love about the product is that it's top level choice. And we're talking about certified Angus beef. They're really picking the highest grade of choice that's available, and they have tougher standards. And so you're going to get a more consistent eating experience, and just, you're going to have a really, really great, you know, steak. And so we're going to show you guys how to cook some steak today. What I thought would be fun is, I was trying to think, when you're doing steak, sometimes you just want it to be simple, right? Because you want to feature the steak. And then I thought about, well, what can I do to steak that adds a little bit of, you know, fun to it, but doesn't overtake the steak? And I thought, well, you know, I love to go to Korean restaurants. I love Korean barbecue. So I use that as an inspiration point. And we're going to do sort of a sesame marinated steak. We're going to do some marinated scallions. And so it sort of has this Psalm-esque quality to it. And I'm going to do at the end, we'll do a kind of a Psalm presentation, but you could also just grill the steak the way I'm showing to you, serve it whole, serve everything on the side, and it'll be super delicious. Couple of housekeeping notes, right? If you have questions, please use the chat feature and ask all your questions, and say again, the Q&A feature, and we'll answer your questions. Either myself will answer them, or Cheryl and Trisha will answer them, because between the three of us, I think there's a pretty good wealth of knowledge. Just the other thing I wanted to mention is that we did this once. We cooked outside once, and someone said, wow, that's cool fake background. I want to just call this out. That is for real. That is real Koala Mountain Range. Okay, so I want you to know we're live on the windward side, and that is not fake. As the sun kind of changes, we'll, you know, hopefully you get to see a little bit more of the mountain range. But it's a beautiful day outside, total summer, and we're just having a great time. Beautiful trade winds, 8 to 10 miles per hour. All right, let's get started. By the way, question. I didn't do my homework, but for those of you that want to go have a steak after this, if they go to Foodland, right? What's the if you text steak to 62924, you get a $3 off coupon on your purchase. So don't forget about that. All right. So real quick, we're gonna be doing porterhouse steaks here, and I want to show them to you real quick. I have a value pack here, and these are 1.5 inch thick. And what I did was I went to our butcher and I said, hey, can I have thicker cuts? And so I wanted to just call out the fact to everyone that we love to do things custom for you. And so if you want to ring the bell, ask the guy for cut a particular thickness, they're happy to do it. In general, we tend to do like a 3/4 inch to 1 inch steak, because after a while, you know, the thicker the steak, the weight gets bigger, right? And so this sweet spot's like a 3/4 inch to 1 inch. But if you want like a steakhouse steak, you got to have a thicker steak. So please don't hesitate. Ring the bell, knock on the door. Our butchers are totally happy to cut exactly what thickness you want. So what I have here is 1.5 inches. And in my opinion, that's the way to go. Okay. So I'm going to get this thing marinated real quick. And, you know, there's lots of ways to cook steak. And I thought it would just be fun to do a sort of a simple marination. So we're adding some flavor, but we're not overpowering the steak. By the way, you know, this particular steak, you can see a little bit of color here, change here. And that's just because the steak was lying on top of it and there was no oxygen hitting it. So part of what makes the red come out is oxygen when it hits the steak. So this is perfectly fine. I did want to show you that this is that T-bone, right? And right now here, this part here, what you're looking at, I should flip this over here. So we're seeing the same pieces. This part here of this steak is the tenderloin. And this part here of the steak would be the strip loin. And so the fun part about a porterhouse or a T-bone is that you're getting a little bit of both at the same time when you have a steak like this. And so It's just kind of fun that way. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to get this thing seasoned and marinated. Now, you can do garlic salt, salt and pepper. What I'm going to do here is I have a little bit of some Hawaiian seasoning salt. We'll just put a little bit on top here. And then I have sesame oil. I'm going to put a little bit of sesame oil on top, which is going to give it some flavor. Also lubricate this so that I grill it easily. I'll flip it over here. Or a little bit more steak. I'm sorry, a little bit more salt. You can use plain salt, garlic salt. I'm using this because I like it's a fun one and I have it, okay? A little bit more sesame oil. And then I'm also gonna add a little bit of lemon. One thing you wanna know is the lemon is acid, right? And acid is gonna be a tenderizer, but also because it's acidity, when you put it on protein, will lightly chemically, we call it chemically cook it. So you're gonna see some discoloration, but that's normal. And that's why I'm not doing it super early. I wanna get some of that flavor in, but I don't wanna go too early. By the way, you know, because I'm cooking outdoors for you, right? Maybe it'd be fun to kind of talk through the setup here. So I got my table, cutting board, knives. I have a kind of a bucket here for my waste. I've got a bucket with water, clean water and a towel so that I can wipe everything. I got my grill setup and my cooler. So this is like when you are getting ready to have your outdoor cookout, the way to impress your friends is have your station set up, your cooking station here, your refrigerator here, and then all of your kind of like utensils here ready to go, okay? We're gonna let this kind of sit for a little bit. Yes.
Question.
Yeah.
Is gochugaru, explain what gochugaru is.
Gochugaru. Where did that question come from? Oh, so that's red pepper. So this is what that stuff is here. It's just red chili powder. This is the product that they use to make sauces in Korean cooking, and you use it to make like kimchi, etc. This was actually this one I have. We have it in the store that we sell, but this was given to me by a friend of mine. Her mom is the boss of the Korean family, and she said that this is the stuff I gotta use. But we have small packs you can buy in the Asian section. Little tiny ones that you can use.
And can you season your steak ahead of time?
You can season your steak ahead of time. Just remember, if you're going to put the lemon juice on, whenever you put it on, the longer it sits, the more it's going to start to like kind of lightly gray. But that's the marination process, and that's totally fine. It's the acid that's kind of chemically cooking the proteins. So the next thing I wanted to show you is I have this kind of going already. And this is the kimchi that we're going to grill. I took the kimchi out, I put it in a colander, and I'm trying to drain the juices out. So right here, kimchi, the juices are coming out. I did bring two of my favorites. This is, if you're here in Hawaii, this is Koha Foods kimchi, and then this is Hymax kimchi. Two different partners, but really nice, like chili flavor and fermented flavor. One thing I wanted you to know, you see how this one here looks really bright, kind of really bright, and this is a little bit, the cabbage looks a little translucent. I've had this in my fridge for 2 or 3 weeks. This one I just picked up from the store today, and you can see the difference in the fermentation. This is a living product and it continues to ferment. The more sour, tart you want it, the longer you let it go. The other thing is when you're going to make like kimchi tofu soup, if you want that really good flavor, you want to let this kimchi really get kind of aged. It's going to really make it a nice, delicious, tart, sour soup. So these are the two different ones. Two really good brands, good flavor. So I put those here for us. I'll put them here, I guess. And then you can see the kimchi that's draining. So when this is draining, we're gonna kind of like push all the liquid out so that when I grill it, it doesn't create too much steam and get crazy. Okay, so now we're gonna go ahead. I am gonna go ahead and put these on. They've marinated for a little bit. I wanna get them going. A 1.5-inch steak is gonna take some time to cook. So I'm gonna get it on the grill. I have my grill full blast. Right now it's showing here at 600 degrees on this grill. And that's what I'm looking for because I want good charring on the outside. So I have my grill. One thing you want to do always is clean the grates. I And then we're gonna go ahead and put it on. Now, this grill particular has a heating element, heating element, heating element. And what I wanna do, because I want really great colors, I'm gonna put it right in the middle. And I'm putting them on at an angle. I'm gonna cook them a little bit. I'm gonna turn them the other direction a little bit so I can get nice grill marks, and then we'll flip them over. When you're cooking a steak this thick, what you're looking for medium rare is about 120 degrees Fahrenheit. Medium is 130. And once you get to that temperature, once the thermometer stops at the temperature, you let it rest and it'll carry over cook and you get that perfect temperature. If you're working with thinner steaks, like 3/4 of an inch type, you're gonna wanna put them sooner. The tricky part is the thinner the steak, the faster it cooks. And so you actually wanna pull it sooner than you think, because it will cook, it quickly cooks and it quickly gets doneness faster. So we'll get this going. We have this ready. One thing I wanted to show you is this is just a cooling rack to do the grilled kimchi. If you have one of those grill pans, that's perfect. But what I'm going to do is use this quickly, and I'll put the kimchi on this when that comes out, so we can nicely char the kimchi. We have our steak going. Getting ready to redraining this. The next thing we want to kind of get ready to do is the kimchi salad. So I have in here, I've already kind of pre-prepped some scallions. And what I did was I cut these and I put them in ice water. And what it does is it kind of gives them a nice curly texture. But it also helps pull out some of the harshness of fresh scallions. If you eat them straight up, it can be a little bit kind of peppery. And so by soaking them, you crisp them up and it pulls out some of that harshness. But I'm gonna show you how I got to that, okay? So I have a scallion here, or a green onion. And there are a couple ways you can do this. So what you're trying to do, I'll use one, is you wanna cut very fine threads. And you can use your knife, and you can go very carefully here and slice them at an angle. And so when you go to Roy's, you know, when you see all those garnishes that they do, that's what you're seeing is they cut the scallions like this very finely, and that's what they do. Now, another way that I wanted to show you that you can do, and honestly, as you all know, I'm not a big like gadget fan, but this one really, I think, made a difference. So I want to show this to you. Let me check the steaks real quick. Okay, we've got some great color. You see that beautiful color? Now I'm going to turn it. I was 45 degrees the other direction. Just like that. Okay? And we'll let it continue to do its thing. I want to show you this tool that I found. And this is what they do in Japan a lot, or in Korea too, when they're making scallion salad. So it's got a bunch of blades and they're spaced out. And all you do is you kind of run them down here. And keep pulling them off. And every so often you might have to get all the way down here. You see that? And I'm using the whole scallion. Trim that. And I'll go ahead and put this in so we can soak with all the green onions I made. Okay, so far, we've got our steak grilling, we've got kimchi draining, I've got scallions marinating. We'll move on to make the sauce for this salad here. And this is a really cool salad. You can use, you, I'm going to show you last minute how to put the sauce on there, because I like my salad to be crisper, but you can also marinate them ahead of time. It just that it starts to wilt, right? But this is a great side dish for Korean barbecue, and it just has really, really great flavor. So we'll let that go. I'm going to come check these steaks in a second here. Let's take a look at what we got. I'm going to move the steak here to another spot, another hot spot. This is a little bit, you see how we're getting a little bit of charring here, which is good because it really gives it that nice grilled steak flavor. Okay, now I'm going to take my grate, and I'm going to put it on top of the grill because I'm getting ready to do the kimchi. And I'm also going to lightly coat this. Okay. And then I'm going to take the kimchi and I'm going to add it to my grill top. Now, what we're trying to do is we're trying to build flavor here. And this is a barbecue, right? So by putting the kimchi on top of the grill, I'm going to give it some smoky flavor, some charring, and I'm going to heat it up as well. So we're adding more character and complexity to the kimchi that we're going to be serving. So now what I'm going to quickly do is I'm going to wipe down this pan here for our steaks when they're ready to come off. And then we're going to start working on the sauce for the scallions here. Okay, so quickly, this is a very simple sauce. And really it's sesame seeds, rice wine vinegar, the gochugaru, sesame oil, shoyu, and sugar. I'm going to start with the liquid. Shoyu is going to go in the bowl. And then I'm just kind of eyeballing this right now. Check the steaks real quick. And then we're going to add our sugar. And I'm adding the sugar to the shoyu so that it can help dissolve it. Rice wine vinegar. I'm gonna stir it up so that I can let the sugar dissolve in here. I'm gonna add my sesame seeds. Chili flakes will go in. And this one you can adjust to your preference, depending how spicy you like things, right? I'm gonna let that all come together, and I'm gonna add the sesame oil last because it's not gonna emulsify in. So I wanted to give this a chance to let all of the sugar dissolve. And then I add my sesame oil. I'm gonna check the steaks here now. Pull those out. We're gonna move this a little bit around. I'm gonna do its thing here. Let me grab my thermometer real quick. And again, like we talked about with cooking, right? Over time, as you get good at cooking, you can eyeball, but you know, it doesn't hurt to check with a thermometer. I got this in here right now. I'm running at, this is 80 degrees. This one here is 90 degrees. So I'm going to put it back on. We're shooting for like 120, right? So I'll put it back on. Let this cook a little bit more, move it around. Let's do its thing. Okay. And we'll bring the salad together.
Can you show us the gadget real quick again?
Oh, sure.
What did you call that? And can you use it on other veggies besides the green onions?
It's, I think they call it a scallion knife, but you know, in Japanese culture, they have negi onions, which is a big fat scallions. They use it to cut really, really thin, fine ones, but it's kind of what it looks like. Has a bunch of blades. You can try, I haven't tried it on anything else except scallions. But really good tool, especially if you're gonna do this kind of work here. Okay, so let me bring this, I'm gonna bring the scallion salad together real quick. I'm gonna take the scallions, I'm gonna drain them, okay? So let me, I'm gonna water my plants a little bit. I'm squeezing out all the liquid here. You wanna get all of that out because the water will dilute the flavor, right? And I'll put it in this mixing bowl here. And you can see these are what the scallions look like, right? They're all nice and curly, crisped up. We're gonna go ahead and add the dressing. We'll go ahead and stir it up. Now I could have, you might be wondering, why did I throw the scallions in this big bowl when I already had dressing in the other bowl? And the reason is that I wanna be able to move this around. If I had been trying to do it in that small bowl, I would probably be, it'd be spilling out. So that's why I did that. But I'm gonna put it back in the bowl here since I have it. We'll just quickly just kind of clean up the bowl real quick here. A nice clean wipe.
Keoni, where did you get that scallion gadget?
You can get them from, you know, Asian stores, or you can get them online. I think if you just Google scallion slicer, you'll find something.
And how long did you have to soak the green onions to make them curl like that?
About an hour. I think if you want to do it fast, if you put lots of ice, it goes quickly. So, but an hour is usually pretty good to get them to curl up like that. So let's see what the temperature we've got here. One thing you got to notice about when you're cooking, right? When you're cooking steaks, it takes a long time for them to heat up. But once they start to heat up, they go really quickly. So, you know, we're at 100 degrees on this steak here right now. That's by the bone. As I pull out the thermometer, it's going up, right? And the reason why, the closer you are to the bone, because of the density of the bone, it's going to be it takes longer to cook because of the thickness of the bone. But right now, see, in the middle of the steak here, what am I at? I'm at like 120, right? So I'm good. I'm going to stop there. I want to let these rest. Okay. Let's see what we have here. Okay, let's check this one here. Yeah, see, look at that. We're looking good right there. Okay. Yeah, I'm pulling them up, I'm just letting them rest, and I'm not sitting them on top of each other. If you sit them on top of each other, they're gonna continue to accelerate the cooking. So I'm spacing them out, I'm letting them get some air, I'm letting them relax.
Do you need to tent them?
You can if you want. I'm gonna leave them like this because I'm getting ready to pretty quickly use them as we bring this all together. If you're tenting them, you're trying to insulate the heat, right? So that's up to you. You can do that, and it just helps hold in some of that residual heat. We've got our scallions, kimchi's working now. I'm gonna pull this off. I see the juice. This is the kimchi juice, right? So I'm gonna take it off and I'm gonna put it back in. So I'm gonna bring it back together. But the reason, like I said, I took the juice out in the first place was because if I had all that moisture it would take longer for the kimchi to kind of brown. And see, you're seeing this kind of like charring, right? That is really gonna bring some nice complexity to the kimchi. And it gives a nice cooked flavor. So if you like, you know, if you like kimchi tofu soup, it kind of brings that, you know, that nice cooked character to the kimchi. Now, what you can do as well, because this has been grilling, right? And I'm gonna look at this right now. It looks pretty good. It's juicy. See how the liquid kind of brings it back? But if you wanted to as well, to just add layers of complexity, you could put some sesame seeds in there. You could hit it with just a little bit of sesame oil if you wanted to. And that helps to kind of bring it together. So now we have our scallions. We've got our kimchi. We've got our steak that's done. And we can kind of start to bring this all together. Now, what you could do, I'm going to show you a couple options, right? If you wanted to, you could serve it as, which dad's not gonna be excited to get one of these, right? You could serve it like a big steak. Garnish it with some of the scallions. Take some of the kimchi. Put it up here, right? You could hit it with just a little drizzle of this for shine, a little bit of freshness. With a lemon wedge. And this is a kind of an interesting alternative to traditional, like hunk of steak with spinach and asparagus, right? And also I think it's fun because I feel like it feels like Hawaii and it feels local because it has an Asian flair. But when you look at the steak, it doesn't look like it was kind of heavily marinated with, you know, teriyaki, and it's, you're not killing and overpowering the steak. So I wanted to show you another option you can do, which I think would be really fun. And it sort of like involves, first of all, a really big platter. You can't go wrong with a huge platter, right? And then I wanted to show you another sauce, which you could do, which, you know, if you're in Hawaii, there's a dish called bichon, which is our version of, basically it's beef typically that's been egg battered and fried, and it's served with two sauces. One of them is sort of a vinegary sweet soy sauce, and the other one is, we call it gochujang, and it has gochujang in it, but it's a sweetened kind of a vinegary sauce, and it's sort of to like similar to samjang, in which is a traditional Korean sauce, but it typically, it might not have the fermented bean paste. It might just be gochujang and some of the things I'm going to show you. So this is really quick and you can do this to taste. But basically I'm taking some gochujang, putting it in a bowl here. I'm going to add a little bit of soy sauce or shoyu, sugar, vinegar. This is rice wine vinegar. So it's very similar to the sauce that we made for the scallions, but it's got the gochujang, so it's gonna have some of that heat. And if you want more of that complexity, you have the fermented soybean paste. And if you don't have Korean style, you probably can get away with, you haven't only have some red miso or white miso for a miso soup, that would also probably work too. What you're trying to do is you're gonna get a sweet, sour, spicy sauce here. And I'm gonna add a little bit of sesame seeds. And a little bit of sesame oil. And this is a really nice dipping sauce here. I'm gonna go ahead and put that dipping sauce in here. you have now a really delicious dipping sauce. And we're gonna start to really build something that's really cool, okay? And if you go to Korean barbecue, you'll see where I'm going. Next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take just sesame oil, straight up sesame oil. I'm gonna put it in a bowl here. I'm gonna take some salt and put it in here. So I'm putting salt and sesame oil. So now I have two sauces. Then I'm going to take some lettuce. This is red leaf. And I did wash it before and put it back in this bag so it's easier to handle. And I'm going to pick some of these. Put them nicely on a plate. Thing is, don't worry about the rest of the greens, right? If you can't use all of them, you want nice big ones like that, okay? And the stems, no problem. Let them be, because you can totally use them for salads. Okay, so now we have beautiful, nice, fresh greens on the plate. I'm gonna take some of the kimchi, put it in the plate. Take some of our scallion salad. Put it on a plate. We'll take our steak here. I'm gonna cut it along that T-bone right there. Following that bone here. And then we're gonna take it and just do some really quick handiwork here.
So are you cutting it against the grain right now?
Well, I mean, sort of, but when you're cutting a steak like this, right, the grain of the steak went with the whole subprimal, and then they cut it this way, right? So I'm kind of going, technically kind of with the grain, but that's kind of really only your option. And this point, this particular steak, a center cut porterhouse is super tender. It's a middle meat, so it's a very, very, very tender, and you'll be fine. So I didn't cut the whole thing. I'm gonna put some of it here, take some of the steak here, kind of like you can put some down here. Wipe. Clear the area here. But here now you can see another option. Yeah, maybe I'll put it here, Chastity, for people, right? So imagine you serving this at the dinner table, nice pair of chopsticks. And then you've got kimchi, grilled kimchi, right? So it's a nice added little special dimension to then plain out of the bottle. We've got our scallion salad. You've got a really delicious looking steak that was grilled beautifully and it's nice and medium rare medium. Oh, and of course you gotta add some rice to that, right? So I have some rice that we cooked. Put some here on the plate. And so now look at that. You have a really amazing kind of fun meal. This can be built for one person, or you can make a big one with steak and everyone kind of like a share family style. But here are two options that I wanted to show and share. And we're kind of getting ready to wrap this up. Are there any last minute questions about grilling steak, temperatures, thoughts, process on how to grill the steak before we kind of wrap?
Is another option to cut the steak in the middle to check the doneness instead of putting in a checking the temperature?
You can cut the steak if you want to, but the thing that what you do is once you take a knife and you cut into the steak, you've kind of make an insertion and then juices will start to come out of it, right? And it's just not that pretty, right? And while you can do that and you'll see what's going on inside, the thing that I think is worth doing, if you're going to commit to buying, I mean, you got to think about it, right? This is a beautiful piece of beef and you're paying a premium for it. A thermometer is $8, right? A good thermometer is $8. And so I think it's worth it buying an $8 thermometer so that you can get a very precise reading, and then you can use accuracy to create a beautiful steak versus like kind of cutting it. And then the thing is, you think about this, you cut the steak, right? And you look at it, oh, it's too rare. So you put it back on, now you have a slit in the steak and it's the juices are coming out. And then you want to check again. So you cut another slit in the steak and pretty soon you have all these slits in the steak. And so I think that if you're committed to doing really, really good food, it's worth the small investment to get a meat thermometer.
What do you?
Any other questions?
Yes. What do you do if you check the temperature and it's just too high?
It's overcooked, and so you're gonna have to. You're basically done. So, I think if you're starting out cooking, right, and you're not familiar with sort of the feel of steak, you're better temping sooner than later, because you can kind of get a feel for that. And then the other thing that I would say is, when you're doing a steak, when you hit 90 degrees, it's gonna take quite a while. If you go straight from the refrigerator to the grill, it will take a while to get to 90 degrees. Depending on the thickness of the steak, 6, 7, 8 minutes. But once it hits 90, it'll go from 90 to 120 in 1 or 2 minutes. And so once you hit that 90 degree mark, that's when you wanna kind of really keep an eye on what the temperature of that steak is. The other thing to remember is, if you're just starting out, you're better off pulling the steak off. And even if it's too rare or if it's undercooked for you, that's okay, because you can always throw it back on. Once you've gone past 130, 140, there's no turning back. So I think those are the things you want to keep in mind as you're thinking about grilling steaks.
And then did you do the lettuce option because you think your guests can wrap, do it as a wrap?
Absolutely. Sorry. So basically what I turned this steak into is like some. Yeah. So you could take the steak. I'll show you real quick. You want to, you know, you could take some rice, put it inside here, right? A little bit of rice. Do a quick dip in here like this. Some scallions, little kimchi, and then you roll it, right? Hold it up, and then you can go ahead and eat it. Delicious that way. So yes, absolutely. Any other thoughts, questions?
Yes. Do you use the same technique for all steak cuts?
I use the same technique for, if I'm grilling, I use the same technique for, yes, all of the grilling or middle meat steaks. So like if we're talking about a strip loin, porterhouse, T-bone, filet, ribeye, all of those tender cuts, absolutely, right? And I guess the inverse of that is when you start to move into other steaks, and those are all the tender steaks that are great to be cooked to medium rare, rare, medium. When you start to work with other steaks that tend to be either tougher or leaner, then you're starting to move into having to marinate. And then when you're marinating those kinds of steaks, that's when you're talking like things like teriyaki, et cetera, where you're going to cut them thinner and you're going to grill them all the way well done typically, but you're marinating with something that's going to tenderize them. So for these kinds of middle meats, we call them, or premium steaks, absolutely, that's the way I would approach them. Other questions?
Can you repeat the code again one more time for the coupon?
Absolutely. And I don't even remember, so I'm going to have to ask our wonderful team here to call it out to me so I can. 2924. Text the word steak to the number 62924, and then you'll get a response with an instantly redeemable coupon for $3 off your purchase, correct? Yeah. So, and it's good from now until July 13th. So great opportunity for that. Any other questions, Cheryl?
How do you prevent the juices from draining out when you stick the thermometer in it.
Yeah, that happens. That's going to happen a little bit. You cannot really, but I think to that point about whether to cut the slit or to stick the thermometer in, it's less invasive if you stick this thermometer in, right? It's a very tiny thing versus cutting a hole, like a slit in the steak. A little bit, it's gonna bleed out, and that happens. Yeah. Other questions?
When is the next class?
Next class is August 11th. So Wednesday, August 11th, the second week of August. I'm working to figure out what we're gonna be cooking, but it's gonna be a fun class as usual. I'm thinking maybe end of summer, beginning of fall might be a fun thing, back to school. So yeah, I have to figure it out. Other questions? Okay, well, I guess I guess we'll wrap this up, and it was great to be back with everyone. I hope you guys had fun learning about sort of steaks and this approach to doing a steak versus just a steak with butter or asparagus. And you know, this is a great dish for all the dads out there. But also, you know, because right after Father's Day, we're going to be moving right into 4th of July. I think this is also one of those great grilling ideas that you can use for your 4th of July event. And don't hesitate to take this idea and add your own creativity to it. This is a great base. This thing is really good neutral because the sesame oil and the salt is really not going to overpower the steak. And whichever way you want to go with this steak and whatever the accompaniments you're going to want to serve with it, they're going to shine. So it was great to see everyone. Looking forward to see you in August 11th. And have a great Father's Day. Have a great 4th of July. And we'll see you soon.